Lorraine Gudas, Chairman of the Pharmacology Department and Professor of Pharmacology and Toxicology at Weill Cornell Medical College in New York City. She is recipient of the 2013 Future of Health Technology Award for her research on new drugs for cancer treatment and prevention.
Well, this is really a very big honor. Thank you so much for giving me this award. It's really a treat for me to be at the meeting today. I've really enjoyed it. This is my first Future of Health Technology Summit meeting, and the breadth of the talks and the excitement of the speakers has been really wonderful. I've learned a lot today, and I think we're all tired, but I've learned a lot. And what I'd like to do, I'm not talking about my own research right now. I was asked to speak about the pharma industry and drugs in general and what the future of drugs holds. So that's the title that I have here. I hope everyone can see. What does the future hold? And I just wanted to point out, this is a picture taken of the East River. So Weill Cornell Medical College is part of Cornell University, but it's located in New York City, right next to Rockefeller. So let me just see if I can. So yeah, if I can just point here, here's the oldest building of Rockefeller University. And this is New York Presbyterian Hospital, the Cornell campus. My lab is, and this is, here's the East River. This is taken from Roosevelt Island. My lab is right there. I hope the lights are on, people are there tonight. And while Cornell is building a new research building, it's just shown in the background here. It's just going to open next year. So just to show you where I live, so to speak, and really live, because I'm there a lot. So I'm going to talk about this topic in this the next 20 minutes or so. So in the United States, we really do love drugs. And this cartoon points out that we now have drugs advertised on television. And what this says is, that pill they advertise all the time on TV. I'm not sure what it is, but I want it. And that, in fact, does happen. Physicians are asked all the time by patients to obtain particular prescriptions and particular drugs. So so if the American culture is interested in drugs and sees drugs as useful for treating diseases, what's going on with the drug development industry and drugs right now? So right now, the pharmaceutical industry is really in crisis. It's in a major crisis. And these are just some articles that were pulled from the internet and from the New York Times. Right now, there's the pipelines are not of the major pharmaceutical companies are low, almost dry. Research and development costs are up about 80% in the last 10 years, and new drugs are down by 43%. So the major pharma companies are merging, they're cutting research, and so what else is going on? Well, there's a big concern. We talked about some of this earlier today, but there's a big concern about the fact that some of the drugs on the market today are very expensive. So for example, this is just from an article in the New York Times, and actually it was in Science magazine as well, and from April 2013, and actually a group of doctors got together and they were denouncing the cost of Gleevec, this drug that's a life-saving drug for cancer patients. But Novartis, a few years ago, was charging $30,000. Now it's charging $100,000 for a dose that will keep patients alive, but you know, that's just very, very expensive. And Brian Drucker and some of the physicians involved in the discovery of Novartis are saying that, or the discovery of Gleevec are saying that Novartis is really taking advantage of very ill patients and charging way too much for its drug. Of course, the drug company will argue that it costs a lot to develop the drug, which is also true. So this is another issue with drug development right now. Another point that, this is a point that I'm particularly interested in, and I think a lot of people don't know this, so I don't know how whether all of you know this or not, but there are major regulatory differences among different types of chemicals. So for pharmaceuticals, there's extensive regulatory oversight by the FDA and the pharmaceutical industry, and some would say over-regulation. I've done some consulting in the industry, and the scientists working in the industry say it's over-regulated, and I can see that argument. So one thing that many people say that's true is that aspirin would not be approved by the FDA today because of the GI bleeding associated with aspirin as a side effect. And yet aspirin is a wonderful drug, and it's over-the-counter, so it's sold over-the-counter. And our current rules in patent law really do present a substantive barrier to treating chronic age-associated disorders. In terms of food additives, we also have major oversight by the FDA to determine the regulatory status of food as an ingredient. So if any company wants to put an additive, a dye, or something else into food, they have to follow strict rules. However, many people are not aware that dietary supplements are considered a special category of food, and they're not considered drugs. So there's very little oversight by the FDA. And I put the dietary supplements, the definition. It's a vitamin, mineral, herb, or other botanical amino acid, or any other substance used to supplement the diet by increasing total dietary intake, or a concentrate, metabolite, constituent, extract, or combination of any of the above. But the FDA has very little oversight capability with these types of supplements. So the public in general thinks these supplements are regulated. They're not. Not well regulated by the FDA. The FDA can send letters to companies, but they can't really regulate dietary supplements. So again, the public thinks that dietary supplements and herbs are closely regulated to ensure that they're safe, effective, and truthfully advertised, but nothing could be further from the truth. And right now, the dietary supplement industry generates about $27 billion in sales per year, and they don't have to prove efficacy. They can't advertise as a cure for a disease, but they can use, they can advertise supplements, dietary supplements. For example, this is just, I just, within 1 second of looking for something, I found this on Google. So these are some supplements. And you see they're not really saying they treat a disease, but they talk about stress, anxiety, natural stress and anxiety, blue skies to treat stress and anxiety. And you can buy these online. But the efficacy doesn't have to be proven. So this is a problem. Now, what other things are happening in the pharmaceutical industry? Well, the research funded by pharmaceutical companies is undergoing really dramatic cuts. It's striking. I see New Jersey has lost thousands and thousands of jobs in the pharmaceutical industry. And it's just really disturbing to see, you know, a federal job training program in New Jersey for laid-off pharmaceutical workers. Last year, Roche closed its major site in New Jersey. And this month, in March of 2013, the major pharmaceutical research center in AstraZeneca in the United Kingdom lose up over 1,000 jobs will be lost there. And then many of the drug giants are giving up. So this is a recent article where the drug giants are giving up on drugs to treat Alzheimer's. They just decided the clinical trials are too complicated, and they've had a few trials that haven't been successful. So they're pulling their research teams and not pursuing these areas. And part of the reason for this is that this blockbuster drug model is no longer realistic. So you know that the more traditional drug model over the last 20 years or so has been this blockbuster drug to get a lot of profits out of one drug. So here you have a patient group that would that does have differences among the people within the group, but they would get the same diagnosis, type 2 diabetes or heart disease, and the same prescription. And for some of them, for most, many of them, the drug will not be toxic and it'll be beneficial. So the drug is helping this group. For other people in different subgroups, the drug will be toxic but beneficial. In other words, have more side effects but be helpful. In other subgroups of patients, the drug will be toxic and not beneficial. And here's another group where the drug is not, doesn't have side effects, but it's also not beneficial. So we, this has been the model, and I just listed below some of the blockbuster drugs from about 5 years ago. So Lipitor, you know, and Advair, Plavix, Epogen or Procrit from, by Amgen. These each brought in over, all of these, each of these drugs brought in over $5 billion in revenue in 2006. Well, that model is really no longer realistic, in part because of some of the genomic revolution we heard about earlier today, and we were having discussions at dinner about the human genomes and the cost of DNA sequencing of human genomes coming down so dramatically that some of us already have, people at this meeting have already had their genome sequenced, but we can gain information from that and it'll become more and more important, but that will break up groups of patients into smaller and smaller groups. And that's what I've tried to depict here. So people talk about personalized medicine as a new revolution, but it's here. I see it all the time. When I talk to people, I gave a talk recently about lung cancer to, quote, the lay public, because I'm a cancer pharmacologist and developing drugs for cancer. And the patients were asking me about different deletions in their tumors. You know, if I have a deletion in exon 5, will this make me more, my tumor more sensitive to the EGF, the epidermal growth factor receptor inhibitors? And so there are many patients, maybe not all, but many patients are quite savvy. But what this will do is break down patients into smaller and smaller groups, so it'll be harder for pharma to recoup its investment in drug discovery, you know, by treating huge numbers of patients with one drug. And then I posit, and I think there's a lot of evidence for this, certainly I know for cancer this is certainly true. Cancer is hundreds of diseases, not just one disease, even one type of cancer, prostate cancer, breast cancer, there are so many subtypes, and now we're breaking them into more and more subtypes. And drugs will work to treat some of these cancer subtypes, but not others. So, but then that may, for pharma, that means the market share gets smaller and smaller. Then someone touched on this earlier today, but autism clearly is many diseases, not just one disease. And Alzheimer's and diabetes, there's evidence for that as well. For the fact that there are many different genetic changes that are mutations and epigenetic changes that can cause these disease, these syndromes or these symptoms. It's not just one disease. So the answer is no, DNA sequencing shows many differences in patients. And then the last point I wanted to make about the pharma personalized medicine. So like I said, personalized medicine, the model for the future is actually occurring now, that we have this, now in many hospitals, as patients come in, they'll have their genome sequenced no matter what they come in for, not just cancer. We're starting to do this at New York Presbyterian Hospital. The DNA will be sequenced, and then they'll be separated into these different subgroups. And some patients without the genetic marker won't be treated with a particular therapy. Other patients with a genetic marker that predicts an adverse event won't be treated. And only a subgroup of patients that will benefit from the drug based on their genome will receive the drug. So this is exciting for patients because we in the past were treating some patients that with therapies that had some side effects, but the patients weren't benefiting from the therapies. But while this is beneficial for patients, it really wreaks havoc with the pharma's general model. And then the last point I wanted to make about this is related to Dr. Minsky's comment earlier about the lack of new drugs for lack of antibiotics for various infectious diseases. And this is a big problem in the pharmaceutical industry. That it's correct that there's only been one or two new antibiotics that have been approved by the FDA in the last few years for infectious disease. And part of the reason for this is also the fact that the profit margins aren't high in these antibiotics. And also, when their antibiotics are widely used, drug resistance develops fairly quickly in the population. A lot of these antibiotics are being used around the world to keep animals healthier and keep them in smaller spaces. But that causes resistance to develop faster in the human population because the resistant bacteria can move from the animals to humans. So this is a major, major problem. And we definitely have a crisis and I predict that we'll start seeing, we've already started, but it will get worse. We'll start seeing patients dying in the hospitals from pneumonia and other diseases that, you know, we thought we had cured years ago, but the drug resistance and lack of new antibiotics is a major problem in the pharma, when we talk about the future of drugs. So where does the public, what can we do about this? Well, where does the public get its information about drugs? Some from the internet, and you know that from all of you know, we've been talking about the internet a lot today. It's spotty, right? There's good things on the internet, and there's also wacky, crazy information. There are also all these TV shows. Dr. Oz, some points on his show are odd, let's put it that way. And a lot from magazines and talk shows. So some of the information that's out there is just incorrect, and some is very misleading. In addition, we have some examples of our Congress people who are also, I would say, uninformed in terms of the way scientific research is done. I don't know if you're aware of this. This just happened in the last couple weeks that Representative Lamar Smith from Texas, he has introduced a bill that would replace scientific peer review with some mandates made by Congress. And most of many of the representatives in Congress are not trained in science, and I think this would have a major deleterious effect. But he's pushing for this bill, so I think this raises some concern. And then we have other members of the House Science Committee, like this is just an example of one of them, like Paul Brown, from Georgia, who I'll just read this. He said, "God's word is true. I've come to understand that all that stuff I was taught about evolution, embryology, Big Bang, it's straight from the pit of hell. It's lies to try to keep me and all the folks who are taught that from understanding that they need a savior. There's a lot of scientific data that I found out as a scientist actually show that we have a really young Earth. I believe that the Earth is about 9,000 years old." So this was from a speech he gave a few months ago. And this is disturbing to me to have someone like him on our House Science Committee. If we want the government to make reasoned choices and decisions about the future of drug development and the future of scientific research, we need to educate the Congress and have congressional leaders who have some basic understanding of science. So this is what I see are four challenges in terms of drug development and the future of the pharma industry, the biotech industry in the U.S. right now. We need to develop better business models for the pharmaceutical and biotech industry that put more money into basic research. We hear so much about translational research, but we also heard today, I was really pleased to hear some of the speakers earlier today talking about the fact that we don't understand a lot of the basis of disease, and we need to put more money into basic research before we try to translate things that, you know, for which we really don't understand the basis. We need to bring personalized medicine into practice at a reasonable cost, and then it would be very helpful if Congress would reform both the regulation of drugs and supplements, and then also reform the use of antibiotics for agricultural uses. Right now, there's a need for reform. And then scientists, both in academia and industry, really must do more basic research into the molecular bases of disease, do smaller and more focused clinical trials reflecting the genetics of the patients, and use genetics to make animal models, primarily mouse models or rat models, that better reflect human disease. These can go a long way to help our understanding before we do larger human clinical trials. And we all of us in this room and all scientists and physicians should play a role in trying to better educate the public and the government officials about science and the nature of scientific research. This is a great need. It's a continuing need. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much for giving me this award and listening tonight. It's been a treat to speak with you and share some of my ideas. And I'm really open for questions at this point. Thank you. Someone must have a question. I made it a fairly controversial speech, but yes.
I'm curious about the nutraceutical story, because you said if you could find a molecule in some naturally occurring thing, then it is a usable nutraceutical. Is that correct? In other words, if you can find a molecule, if you didn't invent the molecule, if you find the, you know, such and such kind of thing that's sometimes used as a food, has this molecule in it, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Like a plant that has a particular molecule in it, and then you could sell that molecule not as a drug but as it's a botanical, and then it's not regulated by the FDA. There's an act called the Deshaies Act in 1994 that then a company could market it, but not for a disease, but you could say for calmness or for stomach ease or something like that. There are phrases that they're allowed to use without any oversight. You don't have to show efficacy. You don't really have to show what's in, you know, what's in that. You can have a mixture of compounds. Yeah, yeah. That's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, it's a huge problem because not only does the FDA not regulate that, but the public thinks the FDA is regulating these. They're spending, it's even more than $27 billion a year. Plus, many of these nutraceuticals can interact with drugs because they affect the liver and they affect the metabolism of other drugs that people may be on. So, you know, it can lead to complications in treatment of, let's say, blood pressure with a standard pharmaceutical drug. So that's correct. Yes, if you find something in a plant, yeah, yeah. So, yes.
When you mentioned the personalized medicine of the, you know, taking every patient genome. Uh-huh.
So the question is, what about the cost of personalized medicine? And I do think it will get very cheap. Everything, you know, when in the lab we used to make oligonucleotides, and I remember when I was still at Harvard, the first one we had made was $1,400 or $1,500 for just a sequence of a few DNA bases. And now, you know, they're pennies, they're, you know, $20. So I think the cost will come down. enough that it won't, the reading of the genetic code will not add, and it will hopefully will not add to the expense, and hopefully it will help in terms of designing treatments. So, yeah.
To what extent is there hope around phage therapy or to replace antibiotics? I understand that in seawater, like a single CC has 10,000 different phages, and that there's some studies overseas that they put them into diabetic leg ulcers and have like essentially sterilized wounds by using them.
Yeah, so the question is, what about phage therapy to replace antibiotics? That's growing, but it hasn't really been, it's not that well developed in this country. So bacteriophage are just viruses that infect bacteria. So the idea, and they don't really hurt us. They don't infect mammalian cells. So the idea would be if you could use those. I think it's a great idea. It hasn't, you know, I think that in the past, the pharmaceutical industry was more straight, they were developing antibiotics and small molecules are easier to give to patients. And but I think this technology has a lot of promise. So I think there was another. Oh, yes, sorry.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if there's an NGO, non-governmental agency, or something that they have that look at these things in more depth in terms of some kind of alternative regulatory.
Well, so the question is, there are smart people who believe in alternative therapies, so what are they reading? What are they learning to believe in these? And I think I've really researched this pretty extensively. So there is a part of NIH. There's something called NCAM, the National Center, I think, for alternative and alternative medicine, and that center does a lot of tests of alternative medicines, and very few tests show any positive effects, beneficial effects. You know, ginkgo, all these different compounds, they've been tested. And of course, the people who believe in these, they tend to say, well, you didn't test the right dose, or it wasn't a good crop of ginkgo, or whatever. But the tests have generally been shown to be negative in good controlled trials. And what are they reading? I think that the scientific literature would indicate primarily negative results with these. So there's a strong placebo effect. You know, I don't want to get into, you know, human evolution, but we as humans, I always think, why is it that we believe, if I tell you this works, you'll believe, we don't know each other, but if you have if you have a friend, you'll believe your friend more than you would an article, you know, in the New England Journal. I mean, a lot of people would. And so what happens with these alternative medicines, I see it in friends of mine. They say, oh, so-and-so told me to take this, and I feel better. But, you know, the data just is not there to support it, to support those kinds of statements. In general, I mean, I actually can't think of a positive study, but there probably are a few, but few and far between. So, okay, well, I'm not familiar. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that, but you have to think about, you know, people are taking these plant products that are not tested, not proven efficacious, versus, you know, a pharmaceutical product that's been extensively tested and, produced under proper manufacturing conditions and things. So but yet it's enormous, you know, the number of people that are buying supplements. So it's a huge industry. Yeah.
Outside the U.S.,
I actually don't know the answer to that. I think that different countries have some different. You mean about nutraceuticals or just in general about the? Yeah, yeah.
Bad things that happen in the U.S.
Yeah.
There's some other country that's taking
I see what you're asking. No, I would say not really. No, I'm not an expert on world pharma. I'm more I focus on U.S. Pharma, but these are multinational companies. So, you know, if they're laying off people, scientists here in New Jersey or you know California, they're also laying them off in England and other countries too, France. And so, I think that the trend in the way these companies are behaving, it's a global trend. I don't see any countries really bucking that trend. Yeah.
Just to follow up on this question, here around MIT, there is a tremendous buildup of pharma. Is this just a smokescreen that the CEOs have to show that they're doing something? Because you go around the artists is building three buildings, five buildings, I don't know how many. Is that real or just a smokescreen?
Well, I think there's some excitement in pharma, and a lot of it is actually the smaller companies, some of the smaller biotech companies, Regeneron and a number, you know, Genentech, which is now huge, but it started as a small, you know, feisty startup compared to some of the larger pharma companies. So they are taking more risks in, you know, as they grow with and tackling some different diseases, not as many Me Too drugs, but well, what pharma says, and I've talked, you know, quite a bit with people in pharma, part of the reason they're here is MIT, Harvard. In other words, some scientists in pharma will even admit, they say pharma is, the model is a failure right now. They're not generating enough interesting research internally, and they don't understand, the scientists don't know enough about the actual diseases and the mechanisms of disease. So they're locating near universities. Now they say that their model is to try to interact more with university scientists, you know, who have more in-depth knowledge of diseases and they can access patients and well, I don't know if I'd say they wouldn't be around, but I don't know if I'd use the word smokescreen, but some of the decisions they make about where they lay people off, and they'll lay a lot of people off in one state, and then they build a whole new research area in another state, and so it's, you know, some of it has probably its economic incentives and other things, but definitely they say, you hear major leaders in pharma say they want the universities to save them. So, you know, and come up with ideas. But whether that will happen or not is another question, but that's what they're hoping, or at least some of the people in the industry are voicing that opinion. So, any other? Yeah. Yes.
That's, I guess, when your question comes to there, or maybe, I don't know, maybe at the beginning of this morning we were talking about how less time we are spending with our doctor, that I can trust more to my friend because she knows probably more about my life and stuff. But on top of that, we don't really trust the pharma companies. Do you think, are they trying to make a better face to the public? Because I don't think it's all the problems of public buying stuff that not FDA approved.
Yes. Well, you make a good point. So her point really is a very good one, and you really hit it on the nail on the head in that I agree with you that I think some of the reasons patients are or people are taking nutraceuticals is it's a backlash against the pharma. They don't trust pharma. And is pharma I can't really answer that. I don't know what they're saying, thinking within the industry. You know, are they trying to make themselves viewed better by the public? You do see some nice commercials sometimes on TV where there's someone in a lab coat smiling and saying, you know, I developed this drug that's treating this disease. But at the same time, Another issue is how the side effects are explained, because that's a topic that we don't really have time to get into tonight. But the way side effects are defined for a drug in the pharma, you know, any side effect that anyone has, they can call in. It doesn't have to be a side effect determined in a clinical trial, a randomized clinical trial. You could say, you know, you're on a drug and then you have a stomach ache that day. You call up and say, you know, I'm taking this drug and I have a stomach ache. And that has to be listed as a side effect. So that's why the company, you know, that's why you hear these millions of side effects. So, I mean, I mention that because that relates too, because people think, oh, the pharma industry is just trying to make profits. And then they also have these drugs that are supposed to have gone through FDA approval, and they have, but meanwhile they have so many side effects. Those sound bad. I'm going to take ginkgo or whatever, some other extract. But in point of fact, it would actually be helpful if the FDA would change the way side effects are determined, and have it really shown properly in clinical trials, instead of, you know, just people calling in. And because you end up with a situation where every drug seems to have so many side effects, but not all of those are proven by what we scientists in this room would call the scientific method. You're right. That makes the drugs look dangerous, and you think, oh, this is in a plant. Well, there are a lot of poisons in plants too. You know that. But it does drive people to take these alternate plants rather than take legitimately tested drugs. So that's a very good point, and thank you for making that. So.